You were at Caterpillar. You said your wife wanted you home off the, off the road. I'm sure there's a lot of people watching this who are going through something similar. And I think what they'd love to understand is, how did you make the decision to go from that corporate job to doing something else? Can you take us through that a little bit?
Well, I can tell you very specifically, a friend of mine named Steve, and Steve had bought a business. And I frankly, it had never, the light went, it never occurred to me that you could acquire an ongoing business. It just never occurred to me, right? You could have a job or you could start a business, but to just buy one, who knew, right? But he found one. And it worked great for him. He was able to make an investment, take over that, add his insights and energy to it, and it went really, really well for him. And we were involved in athletics and exercise, and my wife was a fitness trainer and we've been a coach, and we've always been in that way, and we loved being in the gym. And I had this idea, Chris, that, well, it was going to be like Cheers, right? I was going to buy this gym, and I was going to be there, and I was going to sit there all day long and, and hand out towels and sell drinks and know everybody by name. So we bought this place, and off we go. But I tell you what, a lesson I learned from that transition that I like to share with people, and not to be negative, but it's real. As part of a successful organization, I believe that I vastly overrated my ability as an entrepreneur. I think my own opinion of my business savvy as would be as a business owner or entrepreneur was really jaded by having been actually a cog in a wheel of a really successful team. And so being, that transition from, job and team member to being the decision maker and in the all, the be all end all of making rain and making the place operate and everything in between was a rough one, man. It was really, really difficult. But we kept at it and we got better. And that flip cam was one of the things that we did that helped us get better and effectively connect with people in a way that we hadn't been able to do before.
And I love what you talk about. I think we'll talk about more of that, maybe either the turning point or the aftermath, just about the fact of going from a, being a cog in a wheel to being, being the be all end all. So they get scared some people, and I think also some people don't take it into account. The interesting part though is that one of the things I find interesting is that you were successful at Caterpillar. And but let me not take this for granted. I'm guessing you were, I'm going to ask you a couple of quick questions. You were successful at Caterpillar, right? Okay. And you kind of had a lifestyle that at least supported you and your wife financially, at least at a decent level. I'm not saying you were, uber wealthy, but you at least you didn't want for anything. You weren't hurting for money, right?
No, we were doing all right.
So most people would think, well, that's what's going to make somebody happy. That's what's going to make the wife happy. We're successful. We've got, I've got a good job with a good stable company, and this should all be happy and successful. When your wife came to you and said she wanted you home more, do you remember either a conver the conversation you had or how you reacted when this kind of this change was suggested, or was it a single moment, or was it over a time?
I think it was over time, and I think there was two things. If you look at it, you self he who self reflects the best wins, right? And
Yes.
there were two things. And one thing was, we actually live in the house my wife grew up in. We're entrenched in the community and her family. And the next move in that corporate hierarchy was a move. So for me to make another elevation, I would have had to move to Houston, Texas. And Houston's all right, but that was not high on my family's agenda. So we knew that my career had kind of capped if I was not willing to do that. And but the funny irony of that is in the job that I had, in the job I would have had there, I flew almost every day. I was almost never home. And when you do that, People don't really understand the grind of that travel and the long days that we would have, and then entertaining deal. I was in dealer development work, so we would entertain dealers then in the evening and that sort of thing. It was long days. So the real problem at home, Chris, is when I get home, I was cooked. I'd come home on Friday night and sleep until Monday morning when I had to go back, and that's when she said, "Hey, buddy, if when you're here, you got to be here." Right, and that's still true today. Right, when we're home and with our family, we need to be present with our family, and we've got to have good harmony there. And that's a big challenge for all men. But you've got to be home and present when you're home.
Yeah, you're so right. And it's kind of interesting you bring up the travel because I worked in corporate America and I for a time loved the travel and being a speaker. It's something that one of my goals is to be on stage during 65 days straight, literally one day every 365 straight days somewhere in the country. So I'm ramping up for that huge travel schedule. But the fact of the matter is after a while, no matter how much you love it, it does get to be a grind, and it does get to be, you got to get to the point where you say, okay, this is, any road warrior will tell you that, right? And then it's not just your 8 hours that you're there, but it's the entire day, like you said, at night. Now, the interesting part though is, and I think we'll talk about this more later, I think it kind of predisposed you to the rigors and understanding what it was going to be like to run your own company and to succeed, at least at the beginning, especially from a brick and mortar business, the gymnasium, because whether it's brick and mortar or even what we do here, it's not 9 to 5. I mean, for people who get into this, what we do, and think it's going to be, hey, we're just gonna, make it 9 to 5. I mean, social class suite can make it easier, but it's still not a snap
Takes
your
the pressure off a little bit.
yes,
Yeah,
it's still not a nine.
the grind, working hard in the grind is not hard for me. That comes natural to me very easily. The trick for me, it's one of the things you see, in social media and things today. You see a lot of this rise and grind stuff, right? And that's a big hashtag, rise and grind. The grind comes natural for me. So in my case, rise and shine is what I'm looking for. The grind comes all on its own. So it's the rise and shine part where I have to make sure my mindset is right.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's a great place for us to go and dig a little deeper into the turning point. And you were there, you were successful. It came to a point where things just weren't working anymore at home. So you went and you did what was right. You got into something else that would keep you home. And I think really we have two turning points here. One is the turning point from when you did that into starting your business. And the second one is when you overbranded your business, as you were saying, and it was difficult. So
to watch the rest of this epic episode now, click on the link below the video. Do it now. You'll be glad you did. Are you still here? What are you waiting for? Watch the rest of this epic episode now by clicking on the link below the video.